Okay, cool. So hopefully it's recording now. So we're going to talk about P4A and P4B today. So P4A is just building a scalable web server. So we give you some initial code for a web server that only runs single-threaded. And a lot of this background is basically describing the HTTP protocol and how that server works. And then your part is actually pretty simple, right? You already have a working server, and you just have to figure out how to have threads. So this will be kind of a producer-consumer type problem, where any incoming connection, you're going to have a producer thread that puts those on a queue, and then you're going to have consumer threads that read and respond to HTTP requests. So let me, I'll just run it, and I think that's probably the easiest way to discuss. So we give you all the code. Where is the code? So yeah, so just copy this directory locally, and we describe what all the files are in there, and that's a place to start. So let me head back here. Okay, so you have the server file, and you see that's taking an argument and wants a port number. How many of you are know what a port number is? So, okay, most people. So, yeah, if you take 640, you'll get a really good grasp on all these networking things. But pretty much every machine, or more accurately, every network card has an IP address. And even though, like, you just have this one IP address, maybe you have many different applications running on your computer, right? Like, maybe you have an SSH server, maybe you have a web server, and so on. And basically, if somebody else on the network or internet wants to talk to your process, it needs to not just specify what machine to talk to, but also has to specify which process. So that's what ports are for. So each process may have one or more ports associated with it. So this is asking us for a port to launch on. And I mean, if you try a lower port number, say like 80, I think that's the normal web port, it's just going to fail. So when you're running this, you have to probably do something bigger. And if other people are running on the same machine as you, maybe they'll already grab that port, so you might have to use different things. So I'm going to start up this web server with port 2000, and then I can actually, so you see that I'm on this machine, Galapagos 21. Oops. So I can actually go on over my web browser now, and I can just go there. Which port did I have? 2000, so that's good. Oh, maybe this is not working since I'm not on the CS network anymore. I thought these ports were open, but apparently not. So I guess we also gave you a command line client that you can use to connect to your server, so I guess I'll just try connecting to it that way. Let me see what directory I'm in. Actually, so if I run client, that's asking for a bunch of things. I need to say which host it is, so I'll just say localhost. And so we said port 2000. And then for the file name, let's just try the root directory. So you see this is a home page that it's returning here. This is too bad. This is failing, though. And do a tunnel? Or? Oh, that's a good idea. Nice. Oh, sweet. Were you able to visit the web page? And you said I have to have Google Chrome stable. Okay. I must have it up on another machine. This is looking promising. Okay, so then we can... Sweet. Nice. I think. Okay, yeah, sweet. So you see how there's a little web page here. And, I mean, we can open up different files if we want. So basically anything that in that directory... Here's a makefile. So you actually have to be a little bit worried about security for this project, which there's a little note here at the top Because you can imagine, I mean, somebody could be scanning for ports, and if they wanted to, they could really, I mean, they could type something like that and go off and basically read any of your files. So you probably shouldn't leave it running for long. And if you actually want to be careful, you could try to fix it so it doesn't allow you to read anything except in a subdirectory. So feel free to change it to make it more secure if you like. So both of these pages I visited, both the makefile and this homepage, are examples of static content. So web servers typically will either serve static or dynamic content. Static means that it's just reading a local file and just returning that file over the connection. And then whereas a dynamic program, you might imagine a lot of websites you visit are personalized, right? They might have ads specifically for you, or they might say like, oh, welcome Tyler, or something like that. So people have found it's often useful to, instead of just like reading a file and returning that to the user, it's more useful to run a program that generates HTML for the user. So we have a little program here called output.cgi. And then we can specify a time after that, which is how long it'll run. And oh no. This demo is not going smoothly today. Oh, I must have stopped my server. Okay, so now that's running. So another thing is that some people have been finding that Chrome will actually sometimes crash the server. So it's a very, like, the server is like maybe like 200 lines of code, so it's kind of built for being easy to understand rather than robust. But okay, so you see that this is a dynamic program that ran, and we got some output from that. So let's like start diving into the code and see how it actually does that. Well, first let me open up this output.c program, which is getting compiled to that. So basically, when we have these dynamic programs, it's grabbing everything after the question mark in the URL, and it's setting that up as an environment variable, this query string environment variable. So our C program here, it basically grabs that environment variable, puts it to a float, and then we're spinning for that amount of time, and then we print off some message, right? So all this stuff here, this content length, content type, that's all the HTTP protocol. So it's pretty ugly and verbose, but I mean, that's what we have. So let me demonstrate a problem with this server that you should be trying to fix. So I'm going to run my client, and basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to run that output program twice, and the first time I'm going to put a significant time on it, like 10 seconds. And the other one, I'm just going to do 1 second. So what you're going to see is that the small one, the small time, is going to get stuck behind the big one. Okay, so, well, first let me just run this. I'll just run one at a time. Oops, what's it doing now? I stopped running my server. Okay, so that server is running. And let me see. That's Chrome. Okay, so I'm about to run my two programs. So I run this. And you see that takes about 1 second, right, when I run that. But if I run this longer one first for 10 seconds, and then I run my first one, you'll see that it'll actually get stuck behind the long request, and it'll take a long time. Okay, sure, but it goes through eventually, right? So that's what basically your job is to fix, right? Like, you should be able to do a lot of different requests in parallel, because these requests, well, for one, you might have multiple CPUs, right? So you could take advantage of that. And you should also be able to take advantage if some program is just running for a long time doing I/O or something, other programs should be able to run. So let's dive into this code. So we actually have some nice comments in here even, which are kind of telling you what you have to do. So hopefully this shouldn't be too bad. But basically what this is doing is this is setting up a connection where we're basically going to be looking for new requests, right? So this is listening on a given port, 2000. And then we keep accepting these. So whenever we accept a new connection, say from another browser, we get another file descriptor from that. And this file descriptor we can read and write from. So what we're going to read from it is an HTTP request that tells us which page it wants us to get. And what we're going to write back is the response to that. So you can see this is getting passed off to the request handle, which is in the request file. Let me save this quick. Okay, so we're going to head over to the request file. And this is poorly formatted. So basically, you'll see there's like a lot of wrappers around any type of I.O. Basically, this server just kills itself if it ever gets any errors, and I mean, that's fine. I mean, it's a flaky server, you don't really have to fix that. But basically, what you're doing is it's first reading the request and printing off what it was. So you could see that before when we were running. Let me pull that back up. So you can see that we're getting all these GET requests, and it's specifying which page it wants, and then also which protocol. So it gets that, and then it'll get some other, the header information. And then finally, it's trying to figure out if it's static or dynamic. And this is just a very simple server. So all it does is it looks for CGI. CGI is just a protocol for these dynamic programs. So if it's static, it's trying to pass off to this request serve static. So let me go to that. Right, and this is pretty simple. It just ends up reading a file, and then writing an HTTP header, and then writing back the contents of that file over the socket. Right, so that's pretty straightforward. Let me see about the dynamic one. The dynamic one is also pretty simple. So in this case, basically we use a stoop2 right before we do an exec VE and a child. So pretty much anything that program prints just goes straight back to the client who's connecting, right? And so, I mean, that little CGI program could be anything, right? It could be a C program, it could be a Python. So I even built a simple chat.cgi here. What all this one's doing is it writes out the query string to a log file, and then it reads that back, and then it just writes that out. So I can actually, if my server is still running, which it is, I can head back here. Here it is. So if anybody has their laptop open, you could even visit this, and we could, if there's any questions you want to ask, but you're embarrassed to, like, you can ask via this thing. I built that for that purpose. So, so that's awesome, right? Probably nobody is trying to come to it, right? Because we're not on the CS network. But, what is it doing? This is very laggy. Over. Ah. Dang it. It's like it's doing my keystrokes a second or two afterwards in this X server. What's that? It's no better. Okay, so I guess I'll just have to give up on that. But okay, so let's at least browse some source code some more. So, where am I? Let's head over here. Right. So what do you have to do? First, you have to create a bunch of threads, and so I mean, there's different ways you could do this in parallel, right? Like every time you got a request, you could spawn a new thread. Handle, but what's the disadvantage of that? Yeah, there's a lot of overhead if we're always constantly creating new threads. And not only that, I mean, maybe we don't want to work on too many requests at the same time, right? If we're working on 10,000 requests at the same time, they're probably all going to be very slow because it's probably going to do some sort of round robin thing, right? So it might be better to work on, say, like 20 requests at a time, and then after those are done, then work on the next thing in the queue, right? So it makes sense to queue some up and then just have a limited pool of threads. So basically, what you're going to do is you're going to spawn a bunch of threads, and then down here, when we get a new file descriptor, you're going to add that to some sort of buffer or queue that then these guys will that then these threads will respond to later. So this is kind of like this main program down here is going to be like the producer, and then these threads are going to be the consumer, right? So that should be pretty straightforward. You'll have your I mean, you've seen lots of code like this. You'll have your condition variables and your locks and all that. So there's also, what else do you have to worry about? So there's also, if we go back to the web page, you see that there's some extra credit, which is somewhere. Yeah, so here's extra credit. So basically, I mean, the simple thing to do is just have a kind of a first in, first out protocol. But what you could do is you could imagine that you'll serve some jobs first, right? If you have a lot of requests queued up, you could, if you wanted to, serve what you think is the shortest job first, right? So that's basically what this extra credit is. As a proxy for shortest job first, you just assume that the smallest file will be the shortest to serve. So that's a little bit of a pain to do because when you're enqueuing it here, you kind of have to figure out how big the file is, right, depending on your data structure. I mean, I guess you could also imagine doing it on the consumer side, but it's probably easier to determine the size on the producer side. So what does that mean? That means in this request handle, where you're, basically this is reading to figure out what the file is over in request.c. So it's reading some of this off. Basically, what you're going to want to do is you're going to have to like read some of this information in the producer, then add it to the queue, and then only later will the consumers actually execute either request serve static or request serve dynamic. Does that make sense? So let me show you quick what it actually looks like when a working program. Okay, so in addition to specifying the port number now, we're also going to have to specify how many threads. So I'll say there's 10 threads. And then the number of buffers, how many requests can be outstanding before you can enqueue more. And I mean, that could be bigger or smaller than the number of threads, but let's just say 100 for now. So I have that server running. And where am I? Okay, so I'm going to run two instances of the client now, CGI, and I'll run the first one for 10 seconds, and then I'm going to run the second one. Chrome is doing, like Chrome has, like it'll like try to like prefetch things, so it'll like send extra requests to it, so sometimes the server doesn't like that. That's why it's getting stuff down here before I'm even sending any requests. Oh, that was you. Oh, okay. let me see, so I have this one, I have too many windows open. Okay, so this is going to be 10 seconds, and then this one is going to be just 1 second, and so this is also port 2000, oops, and then again, I'm going to say output.cgi, and I'll just say one. So actually, needs to be a slash before that. Okay, so I'm going to, what does it want? Oh, it needs to say localhost. And then let me get this ready so that I can do it quickly afterwards so you can actually see. And then, okay, so the short one, I'm going to time that. Okay, so I'm going to start the long request, and then I'm going to do the short request. And the short request finishes in 1 second before the long request even finishes because I have multiple threads. So you should be able to test that and see that that's working correctly. So any questions about P4A? Okay, cool. So we can move on and look at P4B now, which is probably it's probably one of the hardest, but also I think one of the most interesting projects you'll have this semester. So basically, right, in xv6, currently there are no threads. You can only have different processes, but you can't have kind of like two threads of execution sharing the same address space, right? So you're going to fix that. So to do that, you're going to be adding this new system called clone, and this is pretty similar to pthread create. It's also going to, the implementation of it is going to be very similar to the existing fork call in xv6. So currently fork, right, it creates a new process in the process table, and then it clones the address space to that new process, right? So then you have two identical processes, each with their own address space. This is going to be doing a lot of the same initialization, but instead of cloning the page table, they're going to be both be pointing to the same page table. So let's first, let me demonstrate what it'll act like when you're all done. So where am I now? I want to go to P4 XP6. So this is, I'm not actually going to show you the code for this because this is a working implementation. But if I go under user, right, so I have this little test program. And this is a test program that I posted on the website. And so this is, it's kind of a little bit of odd code, but it's written to not test a lot of the corner cases that you're going to have to deal with when implementing this thing. So basically, well, actually, first let me, I'm going to just use a fork instead of a clone, so you can see what see the difference, right? So we don't need this yet. So we're just doing a fork, and then in the child, we loop forever, and every 1 second we'll increment our global variable. And in the parent, we loop forever, and we just keep printing that. Oh no. Yeah, so we don't need that, sorry. And then the test was threads. Right, so we see that this just keeps printing zero forever because they're completely different address spaces. So let me kill that now. So instead of that, instead of calling fork, I'm going to call clone, which is pretty similar. And I need to pass that a stack variable where the new thread will have its stack. So let me, I'll be explaining this in more detail, but I have some memory for the new stack. And yeah, I'm just going to print off what the stack is. Well, okay, so we'll run it. So what we should see now then is that this x variable should be shared across both processes. So when the child modifies it, the parent should see it. So, yep, so you can see that that's working as we expected. So, let's, so basically we aren't requiring you, so like last time you had to do a lot of work with the stack, right? You had to move it around, you had to grow and all that. So you don't have, you can throw all that code away, right? Because that would be pretty hard to do in combination with this project. But what you still have to have is you still have to be able to have multiple stacks, right? Because each thread needs its own stack. So, because we aren't requiring you to have what you had last time, the only piece of memory that can really grow is the heap, right? So, if you want to have an arbitrary number of threads, it's kind of weird, but basically, you'll malloc some space in the heap, and then you'll tell the new thread, oh, this is your stack, right? So, it's going to be like you have many different stacks inside of your heap, right? And it's a little weird, but it's actually going to be a lot easier for you when you do your implementation, right? So, I mean, that's what this clone is doing. That's why it's taking a stack. So let's look at fork, and then we'll think about how we would change fork. So I suggest you start this by just making a copy of fork and calling it clone, and then modifying it from there. So let's go look at fork and see what we're going to have to do. Okay, so the first thing it's doing is it's just creating a new process in the process table. And, I mean, each of your threads is going to have its own entry in the process table, right? So, I mean, maybe it would make more sense to rename it tasks or something else like that, or process or thread. But I mean, you can just leave it as it is for now and just get the crux of the program instead of worrying about minor details like that. And now you see this is copying state from P to, well, the process is P. It's copying that page directory over to the new processes page directory. Right, so I mean, all of this is going to go away, right? So both the copy UVM and then the error handling stuff. And what you're going to end up doing is you're just going to actually have both of them pointing to the same page directory, right? So if they're both pointing to the same page directory, this stuff has to be the same, right? They're each going to be the same size. Parent will be the same. I'm in the wrong code base. I don't want to... That was in the code with my changes. I don't want you to see that yet. I don't think you saw anything that will help, so that's good. Okay. So you do some stuff here. So this, you see that each of these processes has this trap frame, right? So in fork, it's basically copying this trap frame. Does anybody remember what's in the trap frame? What's that? Yeah, the stack pointer, among other things, right? So I mean, the fact that we're in the kernel means that we interrupted the user process with a system call or some other thing. So when we go back to user space, we have to restore all the registers that it had before, right? Because in the kernel, we're using those registers for other things, right? So all of those registers got backed up in the trap frame. And when we do return from trap, those are all going to get restored back. Right, so what is this line doing here? So a question even before that is that in the x86 calling convention, right, usually it'll do the return value in the EAX register. Right, so ultimately what happens is when you run some system call, like when you're writing that code, you're just returning something, but something that actually executed that system call is going to take your return value and put that in EAX. So what is this doing here?
It's setting what the child is
going to
see as the return value.
Yeah, exactly. So NP is our child, and then proc is our parent. So that's how, even though we're basically cloning everything, right, we have two identical processes, we can change the return value for one of them, so you can tell which one it has. So what else are we going to have to change here in the trap frame before we return for the thread project? Yeah, we have to update the stack pointer and the base pointer, right? So we're passing in, so if we look back here, we're passing in the memory for the new stack, right? And we're basically going to have to update those here. So let me write some notes here quick to try to make this clear. So let's say that the current proc, that trap frame, let's say that stack pointer equals 0x4 Okay, so that was our current stack pointer. And let's say also that our stack variable that's getting passed in, let's say that stack equals, so I mean it was allocated on the heap, right? And remember that the heap is at the larger addresses now in this version of xv6. So let's say the heap was 9000, right? So we're requiring this to be page aligned. What do you think we might want to set the stack pointer to in the new process? Oops. So what would we set that to then? So remember all stacks now, right? So if we're going back, all stacks are exactly one page and they're always like aligned, right, to page boundaries. So what would I probably have to do here? So this is page number 9, right? So remember that this is hex, right? So I mean, we have 3 hex digits after that, so that's 12 bits. 2 to the 12th is 4096, right? So basically this number here is the number of pages. Right? This is like a page number. Right, so we can determine previously that our page number is 4, right? And now our new page, for our, so our old stack was in page number 4, our new stack is in page number 9. So what would we have to set this to over here? Yeah, exactly. So we'd set that to 9203. And then similarly, well, let's think about what our base pointer might be. Let's say our base pointer, actually I think there's an E in front of here, right? It's probably something like this. So I mean, our base pointer was probably something a little bit bigger than this, so maybe, I don't know, say 12, right? And then we're gonna have to set update that in a similar way. Right, 212. Okay, and so you're gonna have to update these registers appropriately for your new process. And the other thing you're gonna have to do is you're gonna have to copy the old stack to the new stack, right? So you're gonna say, do something like copy page 4 to page 9, right? So now you're gonna clone your whole stack and then update your stack pointer. So when you return, you basically have two threads that are running that each have their own stack, and the stacks happen to be identical, and they can each execute, the instruction pointer will be the same, right? Because it looks like they're both returning to the same place, but they'll have a different return value from clone, and they'll also be running on different stacks. Does that make, yeah? One of you. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. It is. So, right, I mean, we probably want to, so if you're thinking of pthread create, right, like it executes a different function, right? And so, like kind of in old versions of this, or previous versions of this course, they had you do that, but then we made it a little bit easier because that's actually something you can do in user space, right? So just this simple stack cloning is actually relatively simple. So you have this user space library call now that you also have to write, and that's just a wrapper around clone. So this thread create is going to do several things. First, it's trying to malloc space for your new stack. Then it's trying to call clone. And then in the child, it's trying to use this function pointer to know what it starts executing. And it's trying to pass that this argument, of course. And then, so when you clone a new thread, that thread should never exit. It should return when it's done. Because then when it returns when it's done, then that's trying to come back to thread create. And at that point, thread create can free the stack that it mallocked, right? Otherwise, you can never reclaim that memory. Right? Does that make sense? What was your question?
So, my question builds off that, I guess. In thread create, when you malloc, how can you guarantee it's going to be stack aligned?
Right. So, I mean, there's a couple things you could do. One is that you could modify the umalloc, right? To do that. So, I mean, that's a little bit painful. I was looking at it, and I was thinking, well, maybe you could call SBRK directly. But that's actually not a good option because there's no way to like release that then when you're done because we can't support holes in our address space. So kind of the most quick and dirty way to do it is that when you call malloc 2 kilobytes, or not 2 kilobytes, malloc 2 pages, because you know within those 2 pages you can find an aligned page. And then free both of them when you're done. Right? So I mean that's a little bit hacky, but I think without making a lot of changes, I think that's the only simple thing you can do, right? So, I mean, feel free to do something more elegant, but that's a perfectly fine solution.
I was just thinking slamming on malloc
until I got something. Slamming on malloc? That's an interesting solution. But, I mean, you could probably get, you could probably get, well, I wonder if you could, you probably have to randomize your sizes, right, to get, otherwise you can imagine in a case where it's like every, so often you might skip it every time, right?
Yeah.
If you just kept hitting on malloc until you got something you wanted, but. Oh, that's funny. Okay, so far so good. Okay, so we're going to copy to our new stack. We're going to set up these things. And then you see that this is also basically our new thread has its own file descriptor table, and we're copying over all our file descriptors, right? So, I mean, it's fine if you want to leave that code as is. But this is not really ideal. This is not what you'd really get, say, in Linux, because in Linux, if I have 2 threads and one of those threads opens a new file descriptor, then all the other threads could use that file descriptor if they want to, right? Whereas here, since they each have their own file descriptor table, if I do a clone and then my child opens a new file descriptor, the parent can't use that, right? Because the parent has a different file descriptor table than the child. So if you want extra credit, one of the things you can do is you can basically make sure that in addition to sharing the page table, you could also share this O file, which is the file descriptor table, right? And that's probably going to be painful, but it's extra credit, right? So let me see what else we should be talking about. So, I mean, we have lots of hints on here, but let's just talk about the other system calls first. So you have this join call. What is this join call pretty similar to? What's that? Yeah, it's very similar to pthread join. I guess that's true. I guess what I was getting at is that this is very similar to the wait system call, right? So before we forked the process and then we waited for that process, now we clone a thread and then we join that thread, right? So you probably want to either copy the wait system call for this or maybe kind of have like one piece of code, something called like wait join or something like that, that will either wait for a thread child or a process child, and then your system calls can maybe pass different arguments to that, right? So that basically you can wait for the thread to finish. So here's, let's look at the current wait. So wait, basically, okay, so let's say we're running a child process, right? We can't really clean up that child process until a parent calls wait on it because maybe it has some return code or something like that, right? So all of the cleanup for processes right now is not in the exit function, it's in the wait function, right? So when we call wait, then we know that we're done with this child, we can actually clean it up, right? So what you have to worry about now is in your version of join, you have to worry about this free virtual memory, right? Because this is currently releasing the page table. So what would happen if you didn't really change this and you have your multiple threads and one of them finishes running? What's that? Mm-hmm. Yeah, they'd have the same page table, so... Yeah. So basically, yeah, so like the if one thread finishes running and your code is like this, then that first thread will free your page table, and then all your other threads will be very unhappy, right? Because they can't do anything then, right? So you have to worry about that a bit. Kind of one way to think about this, right? Since like each thread or process has a parent, you can just think of it as a big tree of processes or threads, and some of them are threads and some of them are processes. So kind of like wait, you can say like, I'm going to wait for a certain type of child, right? So like when I implemented this, right, I just passed an extra argument here. Like basically I added some like an enumeration or something like that where I could say wait for a thread or wait for a process, right? So another extra credit is that what happens if a parent finishes without joining its children first? I mean, currently, if a process executes without waiting for its children processes, then those processes get adopted by the init process, and the init process will call wait for them, right? And then you've seen this before. You'll get the zombie message from init.c. Actually, let's just look at that quick. Right, so you see in init.c, it's just constantly waiting, and if somebody actually returns from wait, it says zombie. That's because over here, when we do a cleanup, if somebody has kids, where is that code now? I'm losing track of where the code is. I don't want to dig through this all now. But basically, right, if a process executes, all its processes become children of the init process, and the init process calls wait on them and cleans them up, right? So another extra credit is that you can make sure that init cleans up any threads that become orphans. Right? So to do that, you're probably going to have yet another version of not wait or join, but something that can clean up either a process or a thread child. Make sense? Any questions so far? Okay, so in addition to that, you also have to make a very simple locking library. So this is not spin locks, but if you call this thing and the lock is held, you should be putting the process to sleep. So internally, that means that when it gets unlocked, you want to have something like a signal that wakes up a thread that was waiting for the lock, right? And so, I mean, you could imagine doing something efficient where you just wake up one thread that was waiting for the lock. But if you want to, you can just use the calls in the kernel. I think we have a comment about this. If you want to, you can use these xv6 calls, sleep and wake up, to implement that. This is kind of like a broadcast. Let's go look at that. Wake up. So basically, this is drawing, and it's for every. So if we wake up a given channel, everybody that's waiting on that channel becomes runnable. So instead of sleeping, we wake you up. Right? So let me go look at sleep quick. Sleep is just waiting for this channel to get a signal, and it also has a spin lock on it. So what does this do? It's basically setting the state to sleeping, so it won't get scheduled, and it's setting its channel so that if somebody signals the thing we're sleeping on, then it'll just wake us up, right? And I mean, they have this like some sort of void pointer here. I mean, it's just, like, it could have been a number or anything, right? It's just you'll sleep for this address, and then you'll wake up everybody that's sleeping on that address, right? But I mean, this doesn't have to be a pointer to anything real, right? So I mean, what you might want to do is you could imagine having some sort of guard spin lock within the kernel, and when somebody calls your lock, you can quit acquire that guard and then check that memory, and if it is zero, well then you can set it to one and return. But if it was already locked, then you could do this sleep call that will wait on that channel, right? And then when somebody does unlock later, so unlock would be calling the wake up, and lock would be calling sleep. Does that make sense? That was actually, it's not a very hard thing to do, like once you start looking at it. So what else? So we already kind of talked about thread create. Trying to think if there's anything else tricky that you guys are going to run into. Oh yeah, one thing that's tricky is that this SBRK call, right, that's going to grow your page table. And you have to think about what would happen if two different threads were calling that at the same time, right? That's kind of a race condition. So currently, since there was only one process in xv6, they don't have any locking around page table growth. But you're going to have to add a little bit of locking so that when your page table grows, you don't do that concurrently. So, yeah, I'm looking at my list of confusing things. I don't think there's too much else, right? So, I mean, it's a little bit painful to get this right, especially like the clone. I think the other calls are not that hard, but getting clone right, I mean, if you get anything wrong, it'll just crash, and it's kind of hard to tell what you're doing wrong. So just try to be very careful and use that test program we gave you. So any questions? All right, well, I think that's it.